We spotted the first piece of a second Starship Block 2 nose cone, and that's only the beginning. In preparation for Flight 5, SpaceX's teams begin removing parts of the chopsticks. Ship 33 gets its last pieces, testing is right around the corner, and scientists just made a massive discovery on Mars. This changes everything. My name is Felix, welcome to What About It? Let's dive right in. Starship updates. Another day, another whirlwind of activity at Starbase. So much has happened at the world's most advanced rocket facility recently, SpaceX's speed is unmatched. Let's start by taking a look at where every future flight of Starship and Super Heavy will end. I'm of course talking about the chopstick catch arms. We've discussed these catch arms quite a bit over the last few episodes, and some viewers have wondered why we feel the need to explain SpaceX's plan with these more than once. Part of the answer is simple: SpaceX's plan is crazy. Some of us have grown used to the idea over the past couple of years since SpaceX first announced its plan to use these metal arms to catch the world's largest rocket out of the air. What? This crazy maneuver is just around the corner. We are just a couple of weeks away from Flight 5, on which SpaceX plans to test it by catching Booster 12. It's going to happen. That certainly doesn't make it less crazy. But since Flight 5 is likely still a couple of weeks away, SpaceX has time. Time to do what, you may ask? Well, change the basic design of the chopsticks, of course. Yep, SpaceX is overhauling a few pieces of the chopsticks with their first major test right around the corner. For every other rocket company, doing something like this would likely set them back months. But for SpaceX, it's business as usual. It's just being addressed as a side thing, no biggie. So what are they changing? After the second round of tests on Booster 14.1, designed to verify hardware and procedures around the catch maneuver, teams could be seen on almost every part of the chopsticks. And there was one spot in particular that teams seemed to have an interest in. That spot was here, where the two chopsticks meet. As you can see, there's a beam that goes out on both chopsticks and meets in the middle. This beam is designed as a bumper to prevent the chopsticks from closing in too far, crushing a ship or booster, or damaging themselves. Simple concept: when these touch in the middle, it is as wide as a booster. But it looks like these bumpers have caused some problems for SpaceX, because teams first decided to remove the welded on supports, and now they've completely removed them. SpaceX's decision to do this may have several reasons. It's possible they found a better design for these bumpers and will replace them soon. However, it's also possible that SpaceX will completely eliminate them. After all, the best part is no part, and if these were causing problems, SpaceX may have found a different solution. For example, they may have found a way to reliably stop the arms with software instead, and now they feel confident enough to remove these unnecessary parts. The other possibility is that they just don't need a solution. SpaceX's recent testing with Booster 14.1 may have shown that the ship and booster tanks are sturdy enough to withstand the chopsticks closing with full force. The cushions along the chopstick arms may dampen the blow well enough when the chopsticks rapidly close. Speaking of those cushions, SpaceX removed the ones installed for Booster 14.1's catch testing shortly after, and now workers have begun adding mounts along the length of the arms for final installation before the flight. We should begin to see those cushions installed any day now. We will be sure to keep an eye out for them, because it's likely SpaceX made a few design changes, especially after some were damaged during testing. Seeing all the things SpaceX is changing so shortly before they plan on performing this crazy maneuver with a real rocket, you might wonder if they are ready, or why they are okay with risking their only operational Starship launch pad. Some of you even asked, why didn't they just try this maneuver first with a Falcon 9 and a small-scale tower? This is a great question, and the answer to it is pretty interesting and demonstrates SpaceX's philosophy regarding the Starship program. To begin, this maneuver is actually nowhere near as dangerous as it may seem at first. Now, yes, it is dangerous, but even if Booster 12 failed to light its engines and hit the pad at full speed, at this point in the flight, it would have very little fuel left. You have to remember that to perform the landing burn, Super Heavy requires very little fuel because it has already burned off most of its weight by burning fuel on ascent and during descent. Therefore, SpaceX doesn't have to fear having a catastrophic explosion unfold. Look at the pad after Flight 1 and how quickly the massive damage was repaired. But even if they couldn't, it's likely SpaceX would not care and would still choose this method anyway. But why is that? Isn't the infrastructure very important? SpaceX plans to build thousands, or even tens of thousands of Starships and likely many more launch pads. Yes, this is their only launch pad right now, but SpaceX isn't just any rocket company. Building another launch pad for them is not a decade-long task. They even had a second pad nearly built at Cape Canaveral, but tore it down because they were changing the design. Just like that, as much as I hate it, because that pad was in my neighborhood. Put simply, one of the main philosophies of the Starship program is to break things fast and rebuild them better and quicker. A third reason would be that a Falcon 9 booster and a smaller tower wouldn't give SpaceX the necessary data. It would show how a Falcon 9 booster would fare during such a catch attempt. That is a wildly different vehicle than a Super Heavy booster. Translating this data over to Starship and Super Heavy would almost be impossible, so they'd build an entire tower, redesign major parts of a Falcon 9, and end up with barely usable data. But what do you think? Do you disagree and think SpaceX should try testing this with the Falcon 9 first? Or maybe you have another idea? Let us know in the comments. As you can see, the entire team loves reading your thoughts. With so much work being performed on Tower A ahead of Flight 5, you might think that's where most of the action at the launch site this week was. That couldn't be further from the truth. After all, this is SpaceX. But before I tell you about that, we've looked into our channel metrics, and there are over 2 million returning monthly viewers who have not yet subscribed. Help us improve the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you don't miss our updates. While you're at it, give us a like and become a Y supporter. Why? Because you'll gain access to a massive amount of extra content. With it, you get access to daily new Starbase photo galleries, including all those we've posted so far. Satellite, aerial, and ground photos, more than 400 posts in the past 2 years alone, with up to 7 picture galleries per week. Insights, chats with me, you name it, give yourself that extra dose of why you rock. So where's the other action I mentioned? Take a look at this. Moving over to Tower B, we can see that there's been a flurry of activity. Teams can be seen installing many of the final components for the internals of this tower. This includes finishing the guide rails, which allow the chopsticks to move up and down the tower. Most of these were installed onto the tower segments while they were on the ground, but gaps needed to be left where the segments joined, and teams have begun filling in those gaps. A similar thing also needs to happen with the internal piping of the tower, but this is still a lot faster than having to install all of this after the tower is stacked. I'm looking at you, Tower A. Looking down now, the launch mount for Tower B has also been getting a lot of attention. Teams have continued installing the retaining walls around where the new flame trench for launch mount B will go. We discussed these steel walls known as sheet piles in the last episode. Essentially, they act as barriers, allowing SpaceX workers to dig down beneath the ground without worrying about soil or water filling in their holes. These walls are going in fast, so we should start seeing some excavators digging a hole here any day now, followed by a Starship-sized flame diverter. Yes! Hopefully we will see that happen soon. I'm still curious whether SpaceX will use movable launch mounts. We'll talk about that in an upcoming episode. Subscribe to get notified. Infrastructure is the name of the game here at Starbase right now. With the FAA holding up flight tests until they feel confident SpaceX can safely attempt to catch a booster on Flight 5, SpaceX's workers have a lot of extra time on their hands. This is likely why we've seen so much groundwork activity recently, not just at the launch site, but also at the production site. After all, SpaceX needs to build the machine that builds the machine. Musk has even stated in the past that building a Starship is the easy part and mass producing a Starship is the hard one. Hopefully that will put into perspective how important this infrastructure is. Building the world's largest, cheapest, and for the first time fully reusable rocket is the easy part. Easy. Teams are putting a ton of effort into this production line. The main building of the Star Factory should be nearing completion soon, and the rest of it is not far behind. We're likely just weeks away from SpaceX finishing the outside, which includes everything from the production facility to the office building and the new massive corridor connecting them. After that, the only piece likely missing is a third megabay, which has been mentioned as a possibility in the past. Once the external construction is complete, SpaceX teams will still need to install most of the internals, but that should only take a few months. But even though it's not complete yet, we can already see some massive results coming out of the Star Factory. And you're not going to believe what we spotted. Thanks to the Windows SpaceX installed, we can peek into the Star Factory to see what's been going on and check out what we spotted. Yep, that is a new nose cone. After nearly a year of no new starships being built, things are finally resuming. First we had Ship 33 and now we have this. This should be another Block 2 nose cone similar to the one on Ship 33. It may even belong to Ship 34. And that's not all, because we didn't just spot one, we spotted two of them. The Star Factory isn't even fully operational, yet they are already ramping up production. At this rate, the SpaceX team is working faster and harder than a starship on re-entry. This second nose cone has yet to be equipped with heat tiles, but it should get those soon. Of course, this second nose cone will likely be for Ship 35, assuming SpaceX doesn't have another that's even further in development and hidden somewhere. Given what we can see already, it wouldn't be too big of a surprise. Three Block 2 ships are already coming, and they still have two Block 2 ships to launch. Talking about progress. Speaking of Block 2 starships, how's Ship 3 work coming along? In the last episode, Ship 33 had finished stacking operations and reached its final height. Just 3 days after that section was stacked, SpaceX rolled the first Block 2 aft flap into the mega bay to be attached. Just to show how fast SpaceX workers are. It was then of course followed shortly after by the second aft flap. This starship might be flight ready in no time. This last aft flap is being rolled in and likely already attached by the time you're watching this video, which means Ship 33 has all its major components installed and is on the way to being ready for testing. Some of the last things left to do are installing the rest of its heat shield tiles and the Raptor engines. Unfortunately, we couldn't get a perfect view of the flap because of how it was transported. From what we know, the Block 2 aft flaps should look almost identical to the old Block 1 aft flaps. However, SpaceX is likely to have made numerous minor improvements to the flaps, especially after everything they learned during Flight 4's re-entry. If you recall, during that re-entry, there was quite a bit of damage to the flaps after hot gases were able to leak into the flap hinges. Somehow, Ship 29 was still able to land safely. However, its flaps were not exactly reusable, so SpaceX has likely made some improvements. Hopefully, SpaceX will roll this ship out soon for testing so we can get a good look at these new flaps and see how similar or different they are to Block 1. I for one can't wait to see this new design fly. Raptor 3 and all those substantial changes deal a whole new set of cards into SpaceX's hand. Will they be able to go through re-entry unharmed? What do you think? Will Block 2 be the breakthrough? Let me know in the comments. With all the improvements on the new Block 2 ship, SpaceX will want to test Ship 33 and other Block 2 prototypes rigorously. After all, Block 2 has substantial changes and is only intended as a stepping stone to Block 3, which will be significantly larger and more advanced. But first, SpaceX needs to find what they can improve, therefore they need to test. That's why Massey's test range, a former firing range that I actually visited twice back in 2021 and then was bought by SpaceX and converted into a state-of-the-art Starship testing facility, is so interesting. SpaceX has quite a bit of testing equipment here designed to put Starship prototypes through all sorts of torture. And we can see that SpaceX is getting close to its next test on Test Tank 16. This test tank is likely a Block 2 or possibly even Block 3 prototype designed as a test bed to verify the structural integrity of prototypes. This will be the first prototype tested in SpaceX's new CanCrusher 2.0 testing rig, and teams have finally begun to attach the actual crushing part. You can see here that the teams have begun adding rods that connect the CanCrusher lid to the pistons at the bottom, which will pull down to simulate the force of a launch. SpaceX has had a CanCrusher for a while, but this new one can not only crush, but bend as well. I feel bad for Test Tank 16 already. This CanCrusher 2.0 is equipped with pistons to simulate horizontal and vertical forces to guarantee that this prototype can withstand the forces a starship or booster might experience. SpaceX has been hooking these up quickly, and we should hopefully see a test any day now. We'll keep an eye out for you. Remember to subscribe to make sure you don't miss it. Next up, we're moving to Starship's final destination. The Red Planet has given away yet another crucial secret. If this place will be our home one day, we want to get to know about it before setting up camp. Looking at the sheer scale of the Starship program, it is easy to begin wondering why SpaceX needs all this. Why do they plan on building more reusable rockets than the rest of the world has built expendable ones? The answer is pretty simple. In fact, it is one word: Mars. Starships have one goal. Actually, SpaceX as a company has one goal: build a second home for humanity on Mars. Now, SpaceX's goal may have just gotten a lot easier. That's because NASA has found a motherload of water on Mars. I'm not just talking about a small puddle. We've known about water on Mars for a while now. It's even suspected that there is a fair amount of liquid water under the ice at the poles. So what's the big deal? Well, that's not what I'm talking about. In a recent scientific study published in PNAS, researchers analyzed data from NASA's InSight lander and found something truly groundbreaking. They found that Mars's mid-crust, about 10 to 20 kilometers below the surface, is highly saturated with water. That means many of the rocks below Mars's crust are porous. They have many holes that can be filled with other things, similar to sponges. And just like a sponge, these rocks hold water. I need to emphasize, this isn't just a small amount of water. According to this study, Mars's mid-crust area likely contains enough water to flood the entire surface with a 1 to 2 kilometer deep ocean. Have you ever seen the hypothesis of an ancient Mars ocean that's long gone now? That amount of water is even more than the amount initially hypothesized to have covered the surface of ancient Mars and made up its oceans. If this turns out to be true, it could be a game changer for Mars and our future. The importance of this really cannot be overstated. This is incredible. From a resource perspective, future Martians should have little trouble accessing water once they're able to drill down to it. And it is so much that they need not worry about it running out anytime soon. The drilling part could be a problem, as the water seems to be around 20 kilometers deep, which might sound like a lot, and that's because it is. The deepest anyone has ever dug on Earth was 12 kilometers. But that doesn't mean it's impossible. Since Mars's crust is much cooler than Earth's, drilling into it should be much easier than it would be on Earth. Access to water would allow colonists to produce rocket fuel by breaking it into its base components of hydrogen and oxygen. They would also be able to water plants, use it for cooling, and drink it. This amount of water opens up nearly endless possibilities, not just for colonization, but for science as well. From what we know, where there is water on Earth, there is life, and scientists just found a lot of water on Mars. This water could soon turn the dream of a future on Mars into a reality. Of course, more research needs to be done, as this is all based on a limited amount of data from the InSight lander, which shut down after its solar panels became covered in dust. The mission ended in December 2022. Hopefully, this discovery will push NASA and other agencies to look toward Mars once again and fund more missions like the InSight lander, whose data allowed us to discover this. That's it for today. Remember to smash that like button. Subscribe for more awesome content. This is what fuels the algorithm and it does help us immensely. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store. A link is in the description. And if you want to train your space IQ even further, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching and I'll see you again in the next episode. Troublems. Troublems. It's a mixture of trouble and problems. Troublems. Explosion. Yep, that is a no. To look toward Marsk once. Marsk. Marsk!